Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents A Ghoulish Midlife by Leah Davis and L.A. Boruff, narrated by Coleen Marlo. Chapter 1. The door of my Hyundai sedan closed far too softly. I glared at it, certain it was mocking me. Older car doors slammed much more satisfactorily. They were heavier, and the extra weight hitting home could be heard from across the parking lot. Newer models, like my cobalt blue Diahir, weren't all about letting people know I had arrived. It was disappointing, really. But what else was I to expect? Not much was the same anymore. Even phones are less satisfying these days. Whoever heard about slamming a cell phone down in somebody's ear? Oh, sure, I could slam it, but then I'd have to buy a new phone. Pfft, whatever. I was tempted to open the door and try again. Really slam it. Put some elbow grease into it. After 9 hours on the road with only one short bathroom break, I'd seen enough of the inside of that car to last me an awfully long time. Not to mention driving alone was making me talk to myself, and I wasn't that funny. Stretching with my hands on my lower back, I scanned the grocery store parking lot. There were exactly 3 cars, and the building was much, much smaller than I remembered it. That was how things were when remembered from the perspective of youth, though. Everything seemed large during childhood. Although it could have been a result of living for so long in a large city where the buildings were giant compared to that of a small town. The last time I'd been in this particular small town was just last year for my Aunt Winnie's funeral. Why had so many of the people I loved died on me in the last 5 years? First Clay, then my favorite aunt. 2 didn't seem like so much until the grief layered in. With a heavy soul, I'd made the trip on my own then, too. I'd hated traveling without my husband, but he was gone now. A lump formed in my throat. I swallowed it and took a deep breath. It had been 5 years since I lost the love of my life. Well, the first love of my life. The second had left me several weeks ago for a dorm, parties, and medical books. Thinking of the little devil, I pulled out my phone and sent him a text. Wally had insisted I message him the moment I arrived in Shipton Harbor. Nothing like having an overprotective son watching over me, even if he was watching from Harvard University. I should never have taught him how to scry, or that locating spell. I'd never have any peace now. Me. I made it alive, I think, unless I died and my ghost drove the rest of the way. Wally. Your ghost can text? That's impressive. So will you just haunt Aunt Winnie's house for the rest of eternity? Me. That's the plan. Wally. Cool. I'll make sure to visit on holidays. If med school kills me, I'll be moving in. I laughed and replied with, oh, no way. You find your own magical house to haunt. Wally. LOL. Love you. Me. Love you too. I'll call you later. After locking the screen on my cell, I slipped it into my pocket and took another cleansing breath. The fresh scent of the ocean filled me. That was when I noticed the crisp, cool air that had wrapped around me like an old friend. I never used to like the cold, but for the last couple of years, I'd craved it. Hello, early hot flashes. With a sigh, I headed inside the store, wishing Clay were walking beside me. I grabbed the cart while I organized my grocery list in my mind, just as we had done once a week, every week, during our 20 years of marriage. Another ache formed in my chest, tightening it. I closed my eyes briefly and pushed away from the loneliness. Clay would have kicked my ass if he knew I was still grieving him this strongly. We'd promised each other long ago if one survived the other, we wouldn't mourn. We would find the strength to move on and learn to live again. I'd only agreed to the crazy-ass pact because I genuinely believed we'd die within months of each other at the ripe old age of 102. It never occurred to me we'd part ways at 38. But a promise was a promise. I would try to keep it. That was why I'd returned to Shipton Harbor, to fix up the old house and put it on the market. Hopefully, a quick sale. Then I could go back home and decide what to do from there. So, here I was. But before I went to my family home, I needed a few things. The house was totally devoid of all foodstuffs, so I had to get enough to tide me over until I figured out how long I'd be in town, which depended on how much work the old Victoria needed. There was no telling what sort of condition it would be in. After all, it had been empty for a year with no magic to keep it alive. Aunt Winnie's magic had kept the beautiful three-story Gothic building in tip-top shape. It also gave the house a personality that I loved. Without Winnie, it would be cold and normal. Normal was so overrated and boring. As I grabbed a buggy and headed around the produce department, picking up enough of my favorites for just a couple of days. I wished Aunt Winnie had left me enough money with the house to have a caretaker oversee the property. Instead, it had been boarded up for a year. Regular houses didn't do well sitting empty. Magical houses usually died without a witch nourishing them. As I looked at the apples, I fought my sadness. It could have been a lot worse. At least I still had my baby, Wally. So I focused on the mission, sell the house and make enough money to get back to what was left of my life. To the home my son grew up in. To Philadelphia. That didn't mean it would be easy to sell the home that had been in my family for a couple of hundred years. If I was correct, the house had been built before the town even officially became a town. I'd never really paid too much attention to the history of it or anything. Maybe I should have.
Ava? Ava how?
Cringing, I closed my eyes briefly and prayed to the goddess to give me strength. I knew that voice, and it belonged to the absolute last person I wanted to run into tonight, or ever. I was grimy from the long trip, not to mention exhausted. I needed a sandwich and an enormous glass of wine. Or a whole bottle. Definitely I deserve a bottle after facing my number one high school nemesis. Turning, I plastered my best PTA mom smile on my face. Olivia Lockhart. I flipped my long brown hair over my shoulder and prayed I'd be able to extract myself as soon as possible. But high school was a long time ago. We were adults now. It would be fine. It's Lockhart Thompson now. With one hand on the top of a little boy's blonde head, she held out her other hand to show me a big ring. Jeez, a huge ring. Of course, I'd known she'd married Sam Thompson about 5 years before, just in time to have their son, little Sammy. Sam and I had been best friends for as long as I could remember, even after I moved away. We kept in touch. Of course, I'm not used to you with that name, though I'm thrilled my Sam has found the love of his life. I sincerely was happy for him. He and Olivia hadn't been friends in high school, and then afterward Olivia had married and divorced. After her divorce, she and Sam ran into one another when Olivia was rear-ended, and Sam picked up the call. And he'd fallen hard. I'd been a bit dismayed that my best friend was in love with the biggest busybody Shipton Harbor High had ever seen. But who was I to poo-poo on his happiness? Olivia, however, damn well knew my last name. I'd just seen her a year ago at Aunt Winnie's funeral. I'm Ava Harper now, and for the last 20-odd years, I might have been widowed. But I'd kept Clay's name. I'd kept anything that had reminded me of him, even though he'd died 5 years ago. Right after Sam and Olivia got together, actually. That was a hard and dark time for me, but I somehow managed to be happy for my BFF. And in return, Sam listened to me through the tears and then the anger of grief. Olivia put her hand over mine on the handle of my cart. Her sympathy seeped into my hand. And to my surprise, it felt genuine. That was new. The last time we spoke, Olivia had wanted to burn me at the stake, or on a cross. Then again, that was right after she'd found out I was a witch. She squeezed my hand. Sam told me about your husband. I'm so sorry for your loss. She'd said all this with less sincerity last year, at the funeral. I ducked my head and gave the road answer, the same one I'd given any time I went out in public and ran into someone who knew me before my world fell apart. Thank you. It's been incredibly difficult. I can't imagine losing my Sam. But it's been 5 years now, hasn't it? She raised her eyebrows. Are you about ready to start playing the field again? The smile on my face froze. I extracted my hand from under hers and straightened my spine. I'm here to sell the old home place and then get back to Philly. That's all. Olivia's face fell again. Oh, I hate that you're going to sell that beautiful old house. How long has it been in your family? And why were we having this conversation? Oh, right, because Olivia was a busybody. Good to know some things never changed. Yay me. Not. I was just trying to figure that out in my head. When I find the records, I'll let you know. I winked at her and pushed my cart forward a few feet, but she didn't get the hint. So help me, if she didn't leave, I wouldn't be held responsible for my actions. How mad would Sam be if I turned his wife into a squirrel? I'm sure it would be worth the risk. Maybe. I shelved the thought for later. I didn't want to do it in front of little Sammy anyway.
Well, I insist you come to have dinner with Sam and me very soon.
I kept going. That sounds lovely. You can have Sam call me about it. I intentionally didn't invite Olivia to give me a call. I wasn't here to make friends, and I sure didn't trust Olivia. I've got to run now. After seeing Olivia and having to talk about Clay, I wanted to get the hell out of there. I had been feeling like I was ready to think about life after being widowed, but that wasn't at all something I wanted to discuss with Olivia Lockhart or anyone else from my childhood life in Shipton Harbor. I sped around the store after that, snatching up anything I could quickly think of that I'd need for the next 24 hours or so. If I didn't remember it now, I'd figure out how to live without it. The drive to the house took a good 15 minutes. Shipton Harbor was a small town, but the house wasn't in the town. It was on a cliff overlooking the ocean on the outer edges of the city limits. At the moment, that ocean was calm with mediumish waves breaking. The scent of salt water, sand, and sunshine swirled around me, welcoming me home. It was the only thing I missed about Shipton Harbor. Well, that and Winnie. Maybe Sam. Definitely not Olivia. And this beautiful old Gothic Victorian that stood tall against the blue sky with puffy white clouds. With the lights off, not because the electricity was cut off, but because no one was there. It looked sad and, well, dark. I stood beside my car and stared at the home I grew up in. So many emotions churned inside me. A voice from deep inside my mind said to keep the old place, start a new life. But I wasn't sure I wanted to start over. I was 43 for crying out loud. Where would I even begin? Bracing myself, I grabbed my grocery bags and fished the house key out of my pocket. This was the big moment to find out how bad the house was inside. The electricity had been off for the last year, since right after Aunt Winnie's funeral. I only had it and the water turned back on a few days ago, so at least I would have that. Probably. My phone jingled my son's text tone in my pocket. My baby was keeping tabs on me. Couldn't help but smile. He was the one who came with me to Shipton Harbor and cleaned out the house last year. The perishables, anyway. It had been hard on both of us, him helping me in place of his father. But he'd risen to the occasion. Wally was a great kid. Now that he was settled in at college, I had no reason not to take care of this and get the house sold. I'd been putting it off for too long, dreading the flood of emotions I was sure would overwhelm me at any moment. On the other hand, those emotions could have been waiting to catch me off guard, hit me when I wasn't expecting them. I needed to keep an eye on them, keep them locked down tight. The door creaked as if it was making the only sound the house had heard since the last time I closed it. Or was it a sad kind of greeting? Or a cry for help? I couldn't tell. I suppressed a shiver as I entered the open first floor. Everything was exactly as I'd left it. Furniture covered in sheets, boards on the windows, the whole shebang. The air was stale and smelled of dust, old magic, and salt. Hurrying to the kitchen, I put the grocery bags on the dusty white drape-covered kitchen table and flicked on the light. To my relief, it came on. It would be dark in a few short hours, and the last thing I wanted was no power. And that saved me a phone call to the electric company. They were lucky. I opened the fridge and sniffed, then groaned while covering my nose. I'd scrubbed it before leaving it to be turned off, but it still developed a smell. It was at least still clean. I just had to get rid of the smell. I didn't have any herbs to mix up a spell, but I had picked up some baking soda while at the store. Thank goodness for small things. Unpacking my bags, I opened one of the boxes of baking soda and put it in the back corner to start absorbing the smells. The freezer was next. I slid the second box in and remembered I forgot to buy a bag of ice. This old fridge didn't have an ice maker, so I was SOL for my Diet Cola for a while. And on that thought, I realized I might have to replace it to put the house on the market. I'd know for sure when the realtor came by. For now, I'd get the place ready for visitors. Grabbing a towel out of the cabinet where they'd been all my life, I smelled it. It still had a faint scent of the homemade detergent Auntie used. She'd scented it with dried roses. Smiling, I dampened it and wiped out the cabinet my Yaya and Aunt Winnie had always used for dry goods, then put away the rest of the food. With the kitchen settled, for the time being, I walked around the house before I went out to the car to unload the bags I'd brought with me. Ah, but first, the boards needed to go. Drawing on my witchy side and not the other part of me that I refused to use, I used the magic to remove the boards from the windows. The bright afternoon sun streamed in, lighting up each room so there was no need to turn the lights on as I went. The home was built with large windows in each room. I walked out of the kitchen toward the back porch and was surprised when a sense of dismay washed over me. Auntie had always kept an herb garden out here. It had once been full of life and beautiful. Someone well in the past had converted the original porch of the house into a sunroom, then added another porch on the back of that at some point. Both the sunroom and the porch had been filled with a variety of herbs and flowers during Aunt Winnie's life. Seeing it without all the little pots of greenery only drove home that I'd never see my Aunt Winnie again. She'd raised me, along with my grandmother, Yaya, and filled the hole that would have been there from losing my parents at such a young age. My amazing parents were Beth and John Howe. I was 5 when Dad died in a car accident while coming home from work. I didn't remember much about him, but the few memories I had were happy, and I cherished having that piece of him. We moved in here after that and became a house full of witches. Mom's death had hit me hard. I was 10, and she climbed a ladder to hang some holiday lights. A freak bolt of lightning had hit her. She was dead before she even fell off the ladder. Shaking out of the memory, I backed into the kitchen, closing the door to the sunroom and my memories with it. Then I continued through the rest of the house to finish uncovering everything. Before heading upstairs, I grabbed my bags from Daya, my very tired car. One more thing I'd probably have to replace soon. I lugged my bag of clothing up the stairs and into my old bedroom. Somehow I couldn't bring myself to use Aunt Winnie's. All her things were still in there, for one thing, and it still smelled faintly like her verbena perfume. I wanted to keep it that way because it felt like she was still with me. My old bed would do fine. As I looked into Aunt Winnie's bedroom on my way to mine, a tinkling crash behind me made me jump nearly out of my skin. I whirled around to find one of the many, many knickknacks had fallen off of the bureau lining one wall of the large hallway. Glaring at the trinket, I wasn't sure what I expected it to do. A song and dance, maybe? If it did, I was getting back in Daya and hauling tail. Magical house that wasn't so magical anymore was one thing, but animated objects singing and dancing? No way, no how. My sanity couldn't take it. I was sure it was probably from all the open windows and the vibrations of the house settling from having someone move around inside it after a year. What else could it be? No ghosts were around. I'd know. My other powers, that I would not think about, would have alerted me if that was the case. I brushed it off and finished settling in for the night. It was nothing. Chapter 2. Twirling my finger in a circular motion, I pushed a small bit of magic into the air and smiled as tiny tornadoes whipped around the room, gathering up dust from the floor, shelves, and even off of the walls and pulled it to the center of the room. Then, I conjured a larger tornado to collect the pile the smaller ones created. I opened the door and ushered the larger cyclone out and all the dirt with it. "Thank you kindly," I told the magic as it moved outside. The tornado made my hair twirl at the end, acknowledging my thanks. Smiling, I moved room to room, loving the feel and smell of the brisk fall air drifting in from the opened windows. I repeated the spell, dusting each room and evicting the grime out of each window. Since I'd removed all the sheets earlier, this trip through the house was all about taking note of what needed to be done. I'd already noticed several repairs that were needed, not to mention the furnishings were too obsolete for the buying market. But I loved the old, outdated Victorian. So would the family that bought her. As I went along, I conjured a notepad and pen and with a little magic animated them, so they'd follow me and make a list of things I needed to get at the store. I conjured another set to make notes of repairs needed. All this drama, the sudden action of coming home and doing all this had been making me want to get my butt back in a chair. Something about being in this house and in Shipton woke up my muse.
For the first time in 5 years, story ideas were buzzing in my head. After the supply list was complete, I decided to get the office set up since it was clear that being home had ignited my creative juices. I hadn't written any significant amount of words since I moved away. Then nothing since Clay died. Must have been the salty air. My office was exactly how I left it, as if it were waiting on my return. I wasn't staying, but didn't mean I couldn't use it while I was here. Once I cleared out the dust and laughed at the old typewriter, I set up my laptop and the few supplies I'd brought with me, which included the million notebooks in my post-it note stash. I may have a little notebook hoarding problem. It was well after the witching hour, and I realized I'd never made it to the store. Once I hit my office chair and turned on my laptop, the voices in my head chatted about all the adventures they were going on and words started flowing. The next thing I knew, it was pitch black outside and I had 4 chapters written on a book I hadn't even realized was in me. Hot damn! Grinning, I sat back in my comfy chair and read back over what I'd written, surprised to find it as good as I'd hoped it would be as I'd typed. An abundance of pride and ambition filled me. I haven't written like that since before I met Clay. Even after we were married, I wrote and published, taking a break from it all to raise Wally. I returned to it when he went to school because I didn't need to work. Clay made enough money, so we lived comfortably. My royalties were my mad money. Not that the money was mad. It was happy to be spent as much as I was to spend it. However, it had been a long time since I sat and wrote 4 effing chapters without my ADD kicking in, and all in one sitting. I stretched my arms, reaching for the high ceiling, a loud groan spilling from my lips. Then I searched my office. There was something I was going to do, but I'd been too involved in the new world I created to be bothered. A noise. At some point during my amazing marathon writing sprint, I'd heard something fall somewhere in the house. I'd been so into my story that I ignored it. Now that I was pulled out of the new imaginary world, I was curious to what it was, if anything. All my life, the house had a magic to it that made it alive. Animated was what Winnie called it. It made noises often just to get attention. However, there was no magic left in the house. I had all the windows open and none of them had screens, so it was either a random animal sneaking in or the wind knocking something over. In the back of my mind, my subconscious brain was whispering that it was a bad idea. Things always ended badly for the lone female in the horror movies that went seeking out what made the unknown noise. Well, I wasn't just any lone female. I was Ava Harper, witch with the dark side. I wasn't afraid to use it. Okay, that was a lie. I hated my necromancer powers. They didn't define me. Plus, I wasn't in a horror movie. If I were, I would have been the first to die. Deciding on taking my chances with the dangers that might or might not be waiting for me, I moved through the downstairs of the Victorian. My bare feet were silent as I checked each room. I didn't find anything that looked out of the ordinary. Strange. I distinctly heard something break. Unless I was going insane, which could be the real reason my muse woke up. That was highly possible. Giving up on finding the source of the noise that I was beginning to think was a product of my overactive imagination, I crossed the large open living room set on getting back to the book I started. About halfway back to my office, a gray blur leaped at me from the stairs like some humongous furry bat. I screamed but managed to catch the large beast in both hands. Snoozles? Excuse me, Mr. Snoozerson. You can't jump out at me like that. I'm old and could have a heart attack. I adjusted the 20-pound, 3-foot-long Maine coon in my arms to keep from dropping him. Seriously, the cat was...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.